holding on, I was thinking about this. And then I realized, this is the last one in the series, right? Thinking about it. During the week, Addington Anglican Church announced on Facebook that Ben Myers would be here next weekend speaking about Marilyn Robinson and the Protestant Reformation. Because when they heard I was doing these five sermons, they agreed to do one for them afterwards. So I must have just mentioned Marilyn Robinson. So tonight, we're not giving Marilyn Robinson, I won't mention her again. But we're looking for a treat. Because instead of being William Stringfellow. Has anyone heard of William Stringfellow?
Yeah.
I think he's one of the most humanly attractive Christian thinkers of the past century or so. Very unusual. When you think of a theologian, what do you normally think of? An ordained person who also happens to be an academic, spending their lives surrounded by books and adoring PhD students. This is really what it's like. There's no adoring people, but there are liberals. You get a certain picture of an intellectual, right? Well, William Stringfellow was neither an ordained person, nor an academic, nor did he fit any of the usual things we would think of as a theologian. His highest, I don't tell you the bad news before I say anything else, his highest aspiration and hope for his life never came to pass. The great project that he wanted to complete before his life ended was to write a book about the service. He wrote many books. One of the books, too, his theology is mostly autobiographical. He wrote a book about the civil rights, not specifically civil rights movement, but about sort of racial problems in America. And it was the story of his own life in that setting. He wrote a book when his partner died about his own experience of grief. He wrote a book when he became terribly sick. He wrote a book about the experience. So he had this autobiographical style. But his true obsession was, okay, Jesus might be the first one. Just below Jesus, like a scale below Jesus, was the service. William Stringfellow loved the service. He used to, when he became quite a well-known Christian author and public figure, he began accepting invitations to go and speak. And he would coordinate his acceptances, get an invitation, and he had this like calendar where all the services would be. And if you had a public lecture that was on at the same time and place as one of the services, you would get accepted. Yes, I'd love to come. He planned his life around the service. He and his partner Anthony Town once took a sabbatical. And what do you do when you get a sabbatical? You go to Paris for 6 months, you go to Berlin, you go to the beach in Los Angeles. They went and lived with the traveling service. And for that entire season, they were a part of the service. They weren't performing, but they lived there with the circus group, and they had the most wonderful time of their lives going to the circus every day. And it just didn't hold it. And they had animals in those days. I think of circus as vaguely seedy and smells of animals out of the day. When Stringfellow was profoundly ill later in life, and was sort of passed out, he reconstructed from memory a miniature. And a miniature model of this surface. The platonic surface still existed in his mind, recreated in his room. When William Stringfellow died, at his funeral, they played, of course, surface music. He had an extensive collection of surface memorabilia in his house, and he would not have wanted to leave this world in any other way than to the sound. You know, he's there always. What is that called? You're a musician. It's not by Mozart or Bach or anything. Is that what it's called? It's got a name. Let's call it an entry. Anyway, so Stringfellow is not your typical academic theologian. As a teenager, he began to wonder if he might be called into Christian ministry, into ordained ministry. And this was because he had a deep interest in Christianity. He was reading theological books, he was asking interesting questions, and he was an Anglican, his whole life, not an Anglican, and the minister of his church knows this boy has an exceptional sort of religious flair. He's got a good religion. Not everyone is, some of you have a rubbish religion.
Christian person,
whatever I do. So, Stringfellow's way of doing this, when If you don't know from Harvard, what's good with that? No offense if you work. You know what I'm saying? If you go from Harvard into the important places, into the good jobs, into the top jobs. Stringfellow, having renounced career, went from Harvard Law School to Harlem, and he found an exceedingly poor black community in Harlem, and in one of those little graffiti shops with broken glass, he set up his own practice there, providing legal services to those who really needed it and who struggled to get access to those sorts of social instruments. And so that's where he worked, and began to churn out these amazing books about the Christian faith. I think the heart of Stringfellow's theological mission is deeply Protestant. Even this whole lay thing, this commitment not to following a job, but to being a certain type of person, deeply Protestant. I think the heart of his mission is this question. The main question I think I put to us is this one. What are we afraid of? What are we afraid of? Stringfellow is, if we can answer that question, then we will know what it is that's ruling our hearts. What it is that forces us into all sorts of conforming to all sorts of social expectations. All these prefabricated roles that are handed to us when we come into this world. What are we afraid of? And we're so eager to please and so anxious to ever put a foot wrong. If we know what we're afraid of, then we'll know what it is that's ruling our hearts. And Stringfellow's indicates what you're afraid of. So we might be a person, spiders, or Stringfellow is behind every fear. He's the big fear, the fear of death. What's the worst thing that can happen to me? Death. And the things that I fear, you know, maybe you think of the instinctive fears, fear of heights, fear of deadly animals. This is the fear of death in particular forms, right? The big fear is the fear of dying. And Stringfellow thinks that the way we organize our lives, the way we organize our societies, is this whole elaborate machine of trying to protect us from death, trying to screen out death and keep it back. And he thinks that what this leads to is idolatry. Now, we think of idolatry as, I don't know, something that ancient pagan people do, right? Making this thing out of stone and bowing up and worshiping. But Stringfellow thinks that modern Western societies are idolatrous through and through. And idol, he says, is the thing that I attach myself to give my life a meaning and significance. If you ask me, who am I really? The thing that I look to help me answer will be my idol. The thing that possesses my heart and tells me who I really am. So Stringfellow says, sure, maybe in some societies they worship physical idols made out of wood and stone. But in modern Western societies, we worship idols like work. Already mentioned this, but the career, which is the thing that rules my life. And any decision I have to make, let's say I'm contemplating whether to have children or raise a family and move to a certain city, those decisions will be subservient to the idol that I serve. The career is the thing that I'm living for. That's where my meaning and my significance are going to come from, right? Or another idol might be family. Have you seen the way some parents, they're not raising their children, they're worshipping their children. Their whole reason for existence is bound up with whether little Barbara gets into the ballet image. Or whether Timmy soccer team wins on that. Like, the parents' identity is so fragile that it is that the parents' own self-worth is constantly hanging Stringfellow thinks that the family, marriage, these are things that are worshipped as idols. Or another one he mentions is sexual identity. He thinks that this is another thing that we can, not just the fact that you have a certain erotic makeup, but an identity, an idea about sex, a kind of group that I've decided that I belong to. And when you ask me who I am, I look to that group to tell me who I really am, to show me what my life means, where I feel it, where I belong. Stringfellow himself was a gay Christian. He lived with his partner, who was a poet named Anthony Town. And it's interesting, though, he was equally critical of the sort of, let's say, family values, heterosexual view of normal life. This is where your life finds significance. Heterosexual love, raising children, leaving yourself a, you know, procreating, leaving yourself a legacy, and anything that doesn't conform to that is beautiful. He thought that was blatant idolatry, right? On the other hand, he was equally critical of what you might call sort of gay culture, gay identity. Thinking about my sexuality as a larger group that I belong to. When he was once asked to talk on this, Stringfellow said, "I obviously don't know what fusses about the Christians thinking about sexuality. As if there's like two or three groups, and once you know which group you're in, you know who you are." Stringfellow says there's probably, this is in the 70s, right? It was probably illegal to become a sexual in those. But he says there are probably as many sexualities as there are human beings. Why don't we make it an idol out of this? Another idol that Stringfellow sort of turned his scathing analysis on, another idol was, here's an obvious one, the nation. The way we will sacrifice ourselves for the nation, serving its interests, the economy, this huge transcendent entity that we're meant to, he quotes the famous saying of the American president, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. You remember who said that? Thank you, because I totally forgot. That's the right answer. That is the right answer. And Stringfellow thought that is the nation as an idol, the thing that I will later come back. The thing whose existence is more important. He's another one. You might find this in your child's speech, but he thinks that the church is an idol. He called these principalities, by the way. Principality being, here's what he meant, a good part of creation. So the family is a good part of creation. Having a sexual life is a good part of creation. Work is a good and necessary part of creation. Society, the nation, part of the way God has planned the world. But Stringfellow thinks that when we turn these things into idols, when we see ultimate significance from these things, they can't differ. They become not pointers to the Creator, but almost demonic powers that begin to suck life dry. Life withers up when we devote our lives to these things, instead of using them to express gratitude. So he called these principalities, and he thought the church, often talked about this, the church, he called it the demonic principality. So here's a little passage. I've got to read this to you as well, so you can hear the flavor of Stringfellow's writing. It's very eccentric. No one knows what I'm talking about. He says, he's talking here about the huge variety of principalities that sort of suck the life out of human beings. He says, these principalities include all institutions, all ideologies, all images, all movements, all causes, all corporations, all bureaucracies, all traditions. social is one of these fallen angels, the demonic powers. Not because he thinks these are evil things, right? Work, sex, family, Harvard. These are God's creatures. They're not evil things. Even Sydney. I didn't make a short list of principalities, but don't worry, it's still a principality. The point is, when these things are worshipped, they cannot supply the life of the dream that we see. And so they begin to deprive our life of its true meaning. Here's an example of what Stringfellow has in mind. One more little example. I might have a job at a university. And let's say the way people can start out with a job, and at some point their whole life be absorbed into that institution. You see, the crime of the doctors, just for the whole way it's set up here in Australia, but it's like your whole life now is service to something beyond yourself. You sleep. Why does anyone get into that situation? Stringfellow thinks immortality. Can you achieve immortality by working long hours at a hospital? Or by marking your students' essays on time at your election? I remember being like that by eight. No. No. Can you actually achieve immortality that way? If to get time to do it, turns out to be empty, futile. So we devote our lives to these things, Stringfellow things, but we come away empty handed. And we turn good things, work, family, and so on, we turn these good things into principalities. That instead of serving us and serving our people, end up ruining us and taking our life away, diminishing our life. So you get this idea. This is Stringfellow's social critique. He thinks that the whole of society is ruled by the fear of death. And what keeps going wrong in our lives is this sort of mechanism of trying to shield ourselves from death. Well, the Christian gospel is a gospel of resurrection. Does this feel like it's going on forever? I'm trying to
just look at the gospel.
Contract is an agreement we made so that we won't be able to kill each other. But there's times, when Christians should exercise their freedom through civil disobedience. Recognizing the power, recognizing the legitimate authority of the state, there's times people and Christians should say no. Not in the spirit of rebellion and anarchy, like giving a finger to the state just because it's, you know, just because it feels free. Not that. But as an act of solidarity with the nation, as an act of sort of deep neighborly friendship, recognizing what's best in our society and taking a stand against what's worse, taking a stand against injustice and exclusion. Stringfellow was good friends with a Catholic activist priest named Dan Berryman. So you probably know more about therapy than I do. All I know is, on one occasion, he like a deathly either after me doing all this civil disobedience stuff, and he wasn't like a nice little symbolic arrest, something like a joke minister, but you know, symbolic protest, symbolic arrest, the cops patch him in the back and send in your own afterwards. He was actually in trouble. Friends were up. He went into hiding in William Stringfellow's house. And at one point, they gathered quite afraid. in my job, if I'm no longer seeking to live forever by leaving a great legacy behind, if I already know that life will win in the end, then it kind of relaxes me in a way to be able to give myself fully and joyfully to my work as a kind of celebration of life, to work because it's like work as an expression of the life and gifts that are within me, not as something that I need in order to find a place where I belong, not as a way of trying to shield myself from my own ultimate demise. If I decide to raise a family, I can do this as an expression, why do they resist? Stringfellow says it's because in that time and place, Right?